Hello everyone, I will speak about a new framework for mixture model parameter estimation, which is heavily inspired by dictionary methods. So I will begin. I will begin with a short introduction on information geometric tools needed for the algorithm I will present. So my basic object is the exponential family. So we have a few notations here. T is a sufficient statistic, theta is a natural parameter, and big F is the log normalizer of the exponential family. You may know that we have different parameterization of an exponential family. We have the source parameters, which are the classical one, for example, mu and sigma for Gaussian distribution. And we have two canonical parameterization for exponential families, the natural parameters, and a dual space, the expectation parameter space. It's very interesting because for some calculation, it is easier to work in some parameter space, and for other computation, it's easier to work on the other side of this triangle. A basic computational tool for a lot of mixture model algorithm in the context of information geometry is the Brinkmann divergence. So we have this expression for the definition. It comes from basic information geometry theory. We also have a big F function, strictly convex and differentiable. Obviously, the Brinkmann divergence is not a distance. We don't have the symmetry property of the distance. But it's a very interesting object because it contains a lot of common dissimilarity measures. So the Euclidean distance, the Malanomis distance, which are distances, but also the Kullback-Leibler divergence, for example. On the algorithmic point of view, a fundamental tool is the Brinkmann centroids. It's very useful for algorithms because the centroids for Brinkmann divergences are known in closed form. We don't need to minimize a problem with an algorithm, with an approximation scheme. We directly have a formula. And since the Brinkmann divergence is not symmetrical, we have two different notions of centroids. A left-sided one, where the minimization problem is on the left argument of the Brinkmann divergence, and the right-sided centroid, where the centroid is on the right side of the divergence. But in both cases, we have a closed-form formulae to compute it efficiently. So why the Brinkmann divergence? It's because there is a very strong link with exponential families, because there's a bijection between exponential families and Brinkmann divergences. We can rewrite every exponential family in terms of Brinkmann divergence. So it means that the log of the exponential family is simply minus a Brinkmann divergences and some other normalization terms. Another very deep link is that the Brinkmann divergences between the parameters of the exponential family allows to compute the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the two distributions. So two exponential families of the same families. Kullback-Leibler between two Gaussian distributions, Kullback-Leibler between two Laplace distributions, but not Kullback-Leibler between a Gaussian distribution and, for example, a generalized Gaussian distribution. So we need to stick in the same family for all the distribution we'll manipulate. And since we have the Brinkmann centroids in closed form, we get the Kullback-Leibler centroids of set of exponential families in closed form also. So it's a very useful tool for the algorithmic point of view to design algorithms working on exponential families. An interesting point is also that we can show that the maximum likelihood estimator of an exponential family is simply a Bregman centroid of the sufficient statistics of the distribution. So we have here a statistical problem, but with the framework of information geometry, we get a geometrical problem which can be solved efficiently. So here we have the parameter in the eta space, in the expectation parameter space. If we want the theta space, the theta parameter, we need to apply the inverse bijection to go from one space to the dual space. I'm working on mixture models of exponential families. So a mixture model is basically a weighted sum of some distribution. Usually, we have the same distribution on every terms of the sum. So a mixture of Gaussian distribution, a mixture of Laplace, a mixture of generalized Gaussian. Usually, also, the number of components is fixed. It's my assumption in the following. We can't make a debate about it, but we have other tools to select it. So I'm not focusing on it. And the goal of an algorithm to learn a mixture model is to estimate the weight of the sum and the parameters of each distribution involved in the sum. In the context of information geometry for exponential families, we have a variant of the famous expectation maximization algorithm, which is called the Bregman soft clustering algorithm. As usual, we have two main steps. The expectation steps, which is simply computing the responsibility matrix. And we have the maximization steps, which can be rewritten using the Bregman divergences. And actually, these steps, these maximization steps, can be seen as a minimization problem of a sum of Bregman divergences. And this part here is simply a Bregman centroid. So we get a justification for the term clustering here. We have here a centroid of the sufficient statistics of the observations. Here we have the heart of my work this day. In the previous slide, I spoke about the estimation of one mixture model given one set of points. Now the goal is to estimate jointly the parameters of multiple mixture models. So I want to exploit the shared information between various sets of points to improve the quality of the output mixtures, but also to improve the speed, maybe the speed to build the mixtures, or the speed to manipulate the mixture, for example, to compare it with some approximation of the Kubek-Leibler divergence. There is a very deep inspiration from dictionary methods, we'll see in the next slide, but also from transfer learning methods, because one of the main ideas is to transfer knowledge between some of the data sets to other mixture models to improve the quality. So I call these kind of things commixtures or comics. We impose one more constraint. We impose that the components of all the mixtures are the same over all the set of points. So we have a first mixture here with some weights and with some parameters for the distributions. And we have other mixtures with also weights, but the parameters of all the mixtures are the same across all the components of the mixtures. So we have different weights. We have a matrix of weights for all the mixture we learn jointly, but we have the same parameters for the distribution for all the mixtures. How to estimate the parameters for comics? We have the co-expectation maximization algorithm, which is simply an adaptation of the classical EM in the case of commixtures. We have the E-step, which amounts to compute a posterior matrix for each of the set of points. So instead of having one matrix, I have one matrix for each mixture model I want to learn. And for the maximization step, I have two sub-steps. The first one is a partial maximization, set of points by set of points. It's the usual maximization step, but only for one set of points. So at this step, I get one set of parameters for each of the mixture models. So now I want to aggregate all these different parameters to just one parameter by components. But it's simply a barycenter, a Bregman centroid. It's simply the average of all the parameters for one of the components. And we can show that this algorithm converges to a local minimum of the mean of the log likelihood on over all the mixtures, because these two steps are simply the decomposition of one barycenter in partial barycenters on sub-set of points. I spoke about the goal to improve the speed of some manipulation techniques on mixture models. For example, for the Kullback-Leibler divergence, we need approximation techniques for Kullback-Leibler between mixture models because there is no closed form in the case of mixture models. There are a lot of different approximation techniques in the literature. One of the best in the state of the art, the best in the sense of the compromise between computational cost and accuracy of the approximation, is the variational approximation. It's very interesting to see that it's a closed form approximation of Kullback-Leibler. We don't need an iterative scheme to estimate the divergence. And in this expression, we see that we need to compute all the Kullback-Leibler divergences between all pairs of components between the two mixtures. In the case of comics, with shared parameters across all the mixtures, we can pre-compute this Kullback-Leibler matrix. So we get a very fast version of the variational approximation because everything is known in a pre-computation step. We just need to evaluate this expression for each pair of mixtures. So in a context where we need to evaluate a lot of Kullback-Leibler divergences, for example, for classification application where the mixture are the representation of some data point, we get a very fast dissimilarity measure to compare the object of our data set. Here we have an example of application. So a very classical example of application of mixture models is a segmentation of an image using a 5D RGBXY description of the image. We build a mixture model on each image, and the segmentation is done by putting each pixel of the image in the most probable class, so to associate it with the most probable component of the mixture. In the case of comics, we can naturally extend this application to a co-segmentation application by looking jointly at all the images. So we see just the output of the algorithm. We get a meaningful co-segmentation of all these three images. And what does it mean co-segmentation? It means that we have the relationship information between classes in the images. We know that this part of the gorilla is the same as this part and this part. So it's a simple extension of a classical example for mixture models. I said also a word about the inspiration from transfer learning. So the idea of transfer learning is to improve the quality of some statistical model, of some mixed machine learning technique, by transferring information from similar datasets to an interesting dataset, which may be more difficult to work on. Here, the idea is to improve the segmentation in the case where we have a very low number of samples for one particular image. So in this example, it's the same co-segmentation example as in the previous slide, but instead of having all the pixels for one of the three images, we only have 1% of the pixel of this image. So in the setup, we have a comix of size 3, two images with all the pixels, and just one image with 1% of the image. It's a difficult task because basically we just don't have enough points for the classical EM algorithm. We can't learn a mixture model with EM with this low number of points. But with CoEM, we are able to transfer information from the two full images to the third one and to get a meaningful segmentation. Obviously, the quality is lower than the segmentation of all the pixels, but it's still meaningful. So the comics are heavily inspired by dictionary methods. So we can forget the estimation of weight part and just look at the parameters of the components and call it a dictionary. So we get a bag of components, a bag of distributions, and the dictionary is simply the parameters of all the components. And we can design an online algorithm which will use this dictionary to learn a new mixture model. As usual in a lot of dictionary methods, we have a training step, which is the dictionary estimation step. So it's simply a comix on some training set. We just keep the parameters, we forget the weight, and your dictionary is a set of parameters of the distribution. It may be costly, but since it's a training step, it's only done one time, so the cost of this part is not really important. And given this dictionary, we can easily build an online algorithm for mixtures. It's a very different algorithm from usual online methods for mixture models. It has nothing to do with online EM, for example. Here's the idea is that we will build a new vector of weight given the parameters we already have. So we'll estimate the weight for the new mixture. And the estimation will simply be done by populating the vector of weight by putting mass to the most probable component over all the members of the dictionary. So when we see 1 point, we look at the most probable component and we add 1 to this bin of the vector of weight. This is a nearest neighbor search. So it's a maximum a posteriori problem in statistical terms, but with the bijection with Bregman divergences, it's a nearest neighbor search with the Bregman divergence. So the naive version is simply a linear search across all the members of the dictionary. The cost for all the points, so after having seen all the points in the online setup, is number of samples times the number of components. So it's not too much because it's the same order of magnitude as one step of EM. So if you look at the E step, it's the size of the matrix of responsibility. Obviously, we can do a lot of improvements by using appropriate nearest neighbor data structures. For example, Bregman-Ball trees, or hierarchical Bregman clustering, or even approximate nearest neighbors, which can make sense if we have a lot of members in the dictionary and if a precise lookup is not necessary. But in the following, I'm simply using the naive version with a linear search. And again, an example of application with segmentation application. I can learn a dictionary on a training set. But again, it's the two other images I showed previously. And if we look at the first column, I get, with bag of components, a meaningful segmentation of the image, which is not so different from the one we get with EM. Visually, the quality may be lower, but it's still meaningful. But more interestingly, we can reduce the number of points in the images. Just a random sample across all the pixels of the images. So for 10% of the pixels, EM still works. Okay, I get a segmentation. And bag of components works also. Okay. But if I take only 1% of the points, EM don't work at all. But bag of components, it's still able to build a meaningful segmentation. And obviously, bag of components is interesting in the case we have only 1% of the points. But we'll see that even for 10%, it's also useful in terms of computation time. If we look at the computation times for the different steps of the algorithm, for bag of components, we have a training step. Okay, it's the cost, which is here. Okay, let's forget it about it because it's offline. We don't care about it if we have a lot of images to work on. But if I look at the full images case, bag of components is obviously faster than EM because we don't have an iterative scheme. We basically just have the equivalent of one step of EM. So bag of components is faster. In the 10% cases, bag of components is a lot faster than EM because EM has a lot of difficulties to converge to a minimum for the distribution, to a minimum of the log likelihood. So it's a difficult problem because we don't have enough points for EM to work efficiently, but it's not a problem for bag of components. And with only 1%, so we don't have a cost for EM, but we have a very fast segmentation. In the two parts, I'm separating the part for the mixture estimation and the time for the segmentation given the mixture. So here we see that the mixture estimation step is nearly negligible compared to the segmentation itself. To conclude, I presented a new framework for mixture models in the case we have a lot of mixture models to learn. The general case is comixtures, comix. We shared the components across all the mixtures. And the novelty here is the bag of components algorithm, which is an online method which works with only a few points from the dataset. We're able to build meaningful mixtures with a very low number of points. And EM is not able to work on it. It's a fast method, but maybe even more interestingly, it's a method where the computation time is predictable. It's not an iterative scheme with a stopping criterion. We just have to loop over all the points. We don't have to wait for convergence. So it may be very interesting in application, for real-time application, maybe, where the where we need to constrain the computation time to process some data set. For example, for video processing applications. Thank you.
Much for the interesting talk. Any questions here? Yep.
In the comics model, in the last step, which is aggregation.
Yes.
Why? Only just computing the mean. Does it come from the equations or other possibilities may exist?
The mean?
Here, you compute the mean value of different eta to obtain this. So does this come out from the equations, from the relations, or other possibilities for the aggregation?
It's an interesting question because I think the most natural way to adapt the Bregman soft clustering algorithm, we may imagine other versions, for example, with fmins. I don't know if we still have the convergence property. But an interesting point, I was very fast on it, is the weights for the different etas. I spoke about transfer learning and the ability to work with very few number of points in some set of points, given full set of points on other sets. This property comes from the weighting of the different parameters. Because I have the same weight for all the parameters, so the importance of a data set with a very low number of points is the same as the importance for big data sets. So it's not simply the mean of weights. There is a little tweak about weights.
And the second question was, does this transfer learning has something with all the methods which are called message passing methods? Message passing between different.
I don't know message passing methods, so I cannot answer. Okay. Okay. I will have a look.
Any other questions? One small question, do you ever run into issues with the fact that you are not dealing with a metric, in fact, that you have a divergence in that it is not symmetric? Well, because you mentioned it's not symmetric, but does it actually ever hurt you in a certain sense, or does it make a difference?
Not for EM-like methods, because we can't prove the convergence of the Bregman soft clustering in the same way as you prove the convergence of EM. So you don't really care about the problem of symmetry in this particular case. If you do other things, like a Bregman hard clustering, it has an importance, but one of the way is better than the other one. So it's also not really a problem. We can choose pretty easily, and with both theoretical arguments and practical arguments, the best way to do.
One small question. So you spoke about exponential families in general, but what is the concretely which exponential family did you use for your images?
In this case, I'm working on Gaussian families.
Multivariate Gaussian.
Yeah, it will work. Actually, I don't have any precise application for it for now, so I'm sticking on the simplest case. If You have interesting things to do with other families, maybe with Riemannian Gaussian families. I would be happy to discuss.
Okay, if there are no further questions, then let's thank the speaker again.